All right, good morning, everybody. I'm Lewis Lenz, the president of Regis Technologies, and we're very excited about this seminar. We're an API development company that takes molecules from the laboratory up into the factory, and we create the documentation that goes with it. Interestingly, we have three 505b2 projects going on right now, and in our case, they're prodrugs. So I think our speakers will talk about how prodrugs could fit in this as well, that the customer wants to change something on the molecule, but still have the same pharmacology pathway. So I'm going to give you the brief commercial on Regis, and then we'll get into the talk. We were formed in 1956 by my father, who just returned from Florida. Kind of fun to have the founder here after 60 years. We're a CMO, specialized in API manufacturing, process development, but we also do all the tech packet that creates your CMC section, such as analytical, validation, stability, et cetera. Our clients are typically pharma, typically work with the smaller pharma companies like in Boston and San Francisco. And we also do some other life science work, such as imaging and one of the glucose blood monitors. Our main business, and I'll just keep it to one simple slide here, would be process development. We take the molecule from the laboratory up into a kilo scale, small reactors and large reactors. And we're the one that fights the battles to get it there. Like, our process chemists have worked with a lot of different things and know that there's engineering challenges as much as there are chemistry challenges to scale the molecule. And we'll work beyond that. Another area we're very strong in is analytical. When I joined the company, or maybe a few years before I joined even, the analytical was TLC at melting point, but now it's much more advanced. The FDA will want you to have very good understanding of the process, good understanding of impurities. So we have a great analytical team that supports the process all the way along. Along with that, one thing that's been interesting is analytical impurities. We've done that by separating them. We also, with our synthesis team, have made some impurities for people. And it shows companies have a real good understanding of the process and impurities and even potential ones. So sometimes they'll have us make one that hasn't shown up, but they want to prove that it's not showing up in the process. One thing recently, we've made an investment in a potent compound suite. Our projects are getting, the molecules out there are getting much smaller in dose and much higher in potency. So we have a potent compound suite, very small scale, up to 22-liter flasks. But with this, we've also gotten better on chemical hygiene and how we handle things in the factory. So a very good understanding of that. And my last slide, we have a video library here of different projects, different seminars we had in the past. Actually, Jason Orloff is right here. You can see Jason. Jason really understands pharmaceutical statistics. But there's ones on evaluation of impurities, structure elucidation, et cetera. So it's very good education on drug development. So that's it for the commercial. And now we're going to invite up our first speaker, who is Aloka Srinivasan. So it's going to be well to pronounce that. Aloka is the principal consultant at PAREXEL, and she's experienced in the assessment of ANDAs, INDAs, NDAs, with a focus on 505B2 applications. Prior to PAREXEL, Aloka was a team leader at the Office of Generic Drugs, FDA. She was also part of GDUFA implementation, which I don't know if we're going to be happy about or sad about the GDUFA implementation, but it is part of it, and established a division for drug substance DMF review at CDER. So let's welcome up Aloka.
Hi, thank you. Thank you very much. And it's wonderful, I mean, to see this gathering of really interested audience. And so the regulatory, today we are going to talk about the regulatory pathway for 505B2. And before I start, I wanted to say that my colleague Partha Roy and I, we are both going to talk on it, but it's not going to be a separate presentation. We are going to go as a continuum, like, you know, where I stop, Partha starts, because we realize that it's better to go that way. So with that, I'm going to start. So the objectives obviously is, where does a 505B2 fit, and what are the objectives of a B2 application? The critical questions and challenges also a few case studies, and I want to talk about the thin line between the 505B2 and 505J, which are the generics. And this is happening a lot, and being a team leader at Office of Generic Drugs for a long time, I have seen, you know, various occasions when companies were taken by surprise when they came with a J and we said, no, this is a B2. So then let's start at the very beginning. What is a B2? So obviously, this is the you know, the definition in the 21 CFR. It's an application that contains the full reports, we wanted to focus on that, of investigation of safety and effectiveness, where at least some of the information can be relied upon for approval and not conducted by the applicant. And for which the applicant has not obtained the right of reference or use. This means that if GSK makes another formulation of metformin, it's not going to be a 505B2. It's going to go into the NDA. But if company X tries to make another, I don't know if that's even possible to make anything else with metformin, but if they think about it and want to make it, that could be a 505B2. So that's a very fine line there too with NDA 505B1s. And this is a little table that shows the three. Of course, for a B1, everything needs to be there. And for a J, your safety and efficacy are assumed. And so basically, what you want to do is you could be a bioequivalent, you could be qualitatively, quantitatively the same, and you get a therapeutic equivalence rating. 505B2 lies right in the middle. It could or could not be bioequivalent. Most of the time, it's definitely not Q1, Q2. And the possibility of the rating, this is actually something that many companies are looking for now, and this has become a very open area. If a product approved under 505B2 can eventually get a therapeutic equivalent rating, an AB or an AP rating. So basically, as we were saying, one end is the new drug, the other is the generic, and 505B2 is the middle. And this middle part is growing and growing and growing and becoming more and more interesting. As drugs get, you know, more and more interesting dosage forms come into the market.